Thank you very much. Well, the way I would like to do that today is to talk to you about the power associated with how we understand religion in contemporary politics and public life. And I want to do that, firstly, by looking at two cases from the European Court of Human Rights that both dealt with religion in public life, particularly with religion in public schools. And as we go through the material, and hopefully beyond the next 9 minutes, I'd like to encourage you to think about the following four issues. Firstly, what is religion and what does it do? That might sound like an odd question. Surely we know what religion is. It's to do with churches and mosques and temples and sacred texts and men in funny dresses, sometimes women as well. But actually, when it comes to practice, the idea of religion, the category of religion, is very highly contested, and particularly what religion does. Following on from that, who gets to decide what religion is? And further, how do they decide and why do they decide? And then the most important thing, because this is why these questions matter, what are the implications of this for our law, for our policy, for our government, and particularly for people's everyday lives? So that's, keep those in the back of your mind as we move on to look at the cases. Take a look at this. What are we looking at here? Someone want to, what are we looking at? Anyone?
Headscarf women.
Headscarf women, thank you. Okay, so what is the headscarf? It's not a trick question, sorry. A piece of clothing. Okay, a headscarf is a piece of clothing. What does it do, if anything? What does it represent? Why do people wear headscarves? As a religious symbol. Okay. Does everybody agree with that? It's a religious symbol? I heard a it depends somewhere. Who was that? Yes? Why does it depend? It can be just to protect yourself from the rain. Yeah. So already we're seeing something that is often associated with religion in the media can have a lot of different meanings depending on context. What about this one? What's this? A crucifix. What is a crucifix? A sign that you put somewhere so people can see that you're a Christian.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So a religious symbol? Everybody agree with that? Yes? Okay. All right. The reason I'm showing you these two pictures is because they were what was contested in the two cases that I want to look at. So the first one is a case called Delab v. Switzerland from 2001. Has anybody heard of this case? No? Okay. Doesn't matter. The case was about a primary school teacher who converted to Islam and started to wear the headscarf in her classroom. Now, there were no complaints from any of the other teachers, no complaints from her students or any of the parents of her students. If her pupils asked her why she was wearing the headscarf, she would say it was to keep her ears warm. So she wasn't talking about her religion at all. Nonetheless, the Geneva Education Authorities ordered her not to wear it because it violated the principle of neutrality, denominational neutrality in education. Ms. Delab contested that this violated her right to manifest her religion under Article 9 of the European Convention on Human Rights. And the case went to the European Court of Human Rights. Does anybody, I guess if nobody knows the case, you don't know how it was ruled. So we'll get to that in a second. The next case I want to look at is a case called Lautzi and others v. Italy from 2011. Now, the cases are 10 years apart, but the reason I'm comparing them is because the Lautzi case explicitly referred to the Delab case when they made their ruling. So, and in order to make a distinction between the two cases. So in the Lautzi case, Ms. Lautzi objected to the display of crucifixes in the classrooms of the public school, the government-run school, where her children attended, as violating hers and her children's right to freedom of religion. The school board rejected this claim and they left the crucifixes where they were. The case went up and up through the Italian court system, all of them rejecting Ms. Lautzi's claim. Ms. Lautzi went to the European Court of Human Rights in 2009 and the court upheld her claim. In 2011, the case went to the Grand Chamber. The Italian government appealed their decision and the case went to the Grand Chamber. So in the Delab case, The court ruled that Miss DeLubb was not allowed to wear her headscarf in the classroom anymore because it violated the principle of neutrality. And I'll take a look at some of the reasons why they made that ruling. They argued that the headscarf is a powerful religious symbol, violating the principle of neutrality. They said it has some kind of proselytizing effect and influences the freedom of conscience of very young children. They also said that it is imposed on women by the Quran and it undermines principles of tolerance, equality, non-discrimination, respect for others, and democracy. That's an awful lot for a headscarf to do. In the Laozi case, the court ruled that the crucifix is a passive symbol and does not violate the principle of neutrality. They further said that there was no evidence that the display of a religious symbol on a classroom wall had any effect on the right to freedom of conscience of the students. It's very different from the DeLubb case. And then finally, the court said the crucifix is a religious symbol, but they allowed that there were potentially other ways of interpreting this symbol. They allowed that the Italian government might have a point when they said that it was an important part of Italian cultural heritage and it was an important symbol that evoked principles of democracy and equality and justice that were important for European society and public life. So I'm keen to hear what you think. What strikes you about this, about these rulings, the differences in these rulings? Shocking. Why? Yeah. Precisely. Precisely the point. The meaning of religion in both cases is deemed to be very, very different. In the DeLubb case, the meaning of religion was it was deemed to be a powerful symbol and it was going to affect the freedom of conscience of the children. In the Laozi case, it was a passive symbol. There's no real clear reason as to why they make the distinction that one is a powerful symbol and one is a passive symbol. The no evidence question is also like the evidence of a proselytizing effect. That's not entirely clear either, how they make that distinction or why one has more of a proselytizing effect and the other one doesn't. The thing that strikes me about the third point there is that in the DeLubb case, there's only one definition of religion that is, or of the headscarf that is allowed. They say it's something that is imposed on women by the Quran. They don't acknowledge the possibility that it could be something that women choose for themselves to do, that it's part of their right to manifest their religion and to honour their religion by wearing it. Whereas in the Laozi case and the discussion about the crucifix, what they said was that, thank you, what they said was that the crucifix could have more than one interpretation. It was a religious symbol, but it could potentially be a cultural symbol as well. Now, obviously, these cases are very, very complex. There's a lot of other factors that come into play when we're looking at these cases. If we were in a classroom, what I would be getting you to do is actually adopt the roles of the actors in the cases, and we'd do a mock trial, a mock court case, so that you would have to go through this. But for now, I just want to focus on these aspects of the definitions of religion. And what does this mean as we go forward? Well, I hope that the next time you hear someone talking about religion in the media or in politics, you will think about the different meanings that religion can have and the power that that has, the implications that that has, because it affects people's lives, it affects their human rights, and it affects our law, our policies, and our practices. Thank you very much.